Hello everyone, I'm your host Kaustubh Pawar, and today in this second session of GPAT online session series, we are going to learn about general requirements for any parenteral formulation, which is a part of pharmaceutics. Then we will also see various sterilization techniques which are taught in microbiology. As we all know, any parenteral formulation should be sterile. That's why it's essential to know various sterilization techniques and its uses. And at the end, we are going to see how to calculate isotonicity, as it's a prime importance for a parenteral formulation to be isotonic. That's why we should know how to calculate isotonicity and its significance, which is a part of physical pharmacy as well as dispensing pharmacy from GPAT aspect. So let's start with our second session. So as you can see in this slide, I have mentioned four important general requirements for any parenteral formulation. First one is it should be sterile. As it's an absolute term, either parenteral formulation will be sterile or non-sterile. So it's essential to be sterile. Second most important parameter is that it should be pyrogen free or endotoxin free. Endotoxin and pyrogens are two different concepts which we will learn in next slides. So first one is it should be sterile. Second one, it should be pyrogen free. Third one, it should be free from particles. And the fourth one, it should be isotonic. So these are the four important parameters for any parenteral formulation which should be fulfilled. First one, sterile. Second one, pyrogen free. Third one, free from particles. And fourth one, isotonic. So based upon this simple concept, in GPAT 2014, there was one question. As it was, parenteral product must be, and there were four options: packed in bottle, sterilized, hypertonic, and pyrogenic. So the correct option is sterilized. So it was a very simple question, and it is very easy to score good marks if you know the clear and correct concepts. So let's revise. General requirement for parenteral formulations are: it should be sterile, it should be pyrogen free, that is apyrogenic or non-pyrogenic. They should be free from particles, and fourth one, they should be isotonic. Next, move to various sterilization techniques. As we saw, any parenteral formulation should be sterile. So what are which all are the sterilization techniques to get a sterile product? So basically, sterilization techniques are classified broadly in two categories. First one is thermal sterilization, and second one is non-thermal sterilization, also called as cold sterilization. Because in this, the heat is not used. Therefore, it is called as cold sterilization. So in thermal sterilization, we have two techniques. First is hot air oven, and second is autoclave. So in hot air oven, what is the method? So the method is, if we want to sterilize any glassware or any equipment, we have to undergo for 2 hours at 180 degrees Celsius in a hot air oven. So in which an hot air is used to sterilize various glassware and equipments for 2 hours at 180 degrees Celsius. So it is the minimum requirement to get a sterilized product from a hot air oven. Then what's the mechanism of action? So mechanism of action is pretty simple. It's an oxidation technique which is used to sterilize any glassware. And for what it is used? It is used for glassware and equipments. So if you make such a simple table or a flow chart of various sterilization techniques or for various other concepts, it will be very easy to revise at the end of the preparation in December and in November. While and it is also easy to revise the various concepts. So now let's move to the second technique, is an autoclave. As we all know, autoclave, it should be run at for 10 minutes at 121 degrees Celsius and at 15 psi pressure. Then we get a sterilized product. So for hot air oven, it is 2 hours at 180 degrees Celsius. For autoclave, it is 10 minutes at 121 degrees Celsius for 15 psi pressure. In here, we use moist heat. And the mechanism of action is protein denaturation or protein coagulation. Due to moist heat, the protein which is present in the microbes undergoes coagulation or denaturation. And thus, we get a sterilized product. And for what we can use autoclave, we can use to sterilize rubber closures, gloves, uniforms, filters, culture media, and so on. So for in our microbiology practicals, we sterilize any culture media by autoclaving at 10 minutes for 121 degrees Celsius and at 15 PSI. Then move to the second aspect, which is a non-thermal sterilization, also called as cold sterilization. In cold sterilization, we have three different techniques. First one is radiation sterilization, second one is chemical sterilization, and third one is membrane filtration. So what is the method which we use in radiation sterilization? Here we use either gamma rays, and as I have mentioned here, we use gamma rays produced by cobalt 60. That is important. I think so in GPAT 2012, there was one question for radiation sterilization, which method we use. In that, the option was cobalt 60 and various other options were given. So the correct answer was cobalt 60. So the gamma rays are produced through cobalt 60. Then also we use X-rays, electron beam radiation. And here the important parameter is what dose we used for sterilization. So dose of gamma rays is 25 kilo GY. So that is the dose of an gamma rays. So we have to remember the dose and the method for radiation sterilization, which is cobalt 60 produces gamma rays. Then moving to its mechanism of action. For mechanism of action, it's either by DNA altering, by depolymerizing the DNA and causing mutation in microorganisms. Thus, we get a sterilized product. So for what we use radiation sterilization, we use for heat labile substances, like for penicillin or for vitamins, that are sterilized through radiation sterilization. Also for catgut, then needles and various disposable syringes are sterilized by radiation sterilization. So that is its use. Then for chemical sterilization, we use ethylene oxide gas for chemical sterilization. And the mechanism which on it acts is by alkylating the bacterial proteins. That is important. So ethylene oxide acts by alkylation the bacterial proteins. And for plastic materials, medical instruments and hospital beddings, they are sterilized by using ethylene oxide gas. Then the last one is membrane sterilization. In membrane sterilization, there are two filters which we can use. First one is 0.22 micron filter and the second one is 0.45 micron filter. Both can be used to sterilize different materials, and this membrane filtration is also used for heat labile solutions or injections. As we cannot use a thermal sterilization for heat labile solution, it will cause degradation. That's why we use membrane filtration or radiation sterilization to sterilize heat labile solutions or injections, and this act by filtration mechanism. So if you remember this chart, you will be able to recollect each and every important aspect of sterilization techniques. And in one go, we are able to complete all the sterilization techniques from microbiology aspect. So please take a screenshot of this so that you will be able to revise these concepts pretty easy at the time of revision. So let's revise for final time. There are two techniques. First is thermal sterilization. Second one is non-thermal sterilization, also called as cold sterilization. In thermal sterilization, we have hot air oven, which acts at 2 hours at 180 degrees Celsius by oxidation technique. And it is used for glasswares and equipments. Second technique is an autoclave, which is used at 121 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes at 15 PSI. It acts by protein denaturation or coagulation, and it is used for rubber closure, gloves, uniforms, filters, culture media, and etc. Then in cold sterilization, we have first technique called as radiation sterilization, which acts by method of gamma rays bombarding through cobalt 60. X-rays, electron beam radiation also used. Its dose is 25 kgy. Then it acts by mutation or DNA damage or depolymerization of DNA, and it is used for heat labile substances like penicillin, vitamins, catguts, needles, syringes, and etc. Chemical sterilization is used for sterilizing plastics, medical instruments, as well as hospital beddings. It acts by alkylating the bacterial proteins, and in which we use ethylene oxide gas. And the last one is membrane filtration, which we have two different filters. One is 0.22 micron filter and 0.45 micrometer filter. It acts by filtration technique, and it is also used for terminal sterilization. Always remember, membrane filtration is used for terminal sterilization. And here we use it for sterilizing heat labile solutions. So in this single go, we are able to complete all sterilization techniques. Now moving to next aspect, which is general requirements of parenteral. As we saw, there were four general requirements. First one is sterility. It should be sterile, which we saw previous. Now there is second aspect, it should be pyrogen free. So what are pyrogens? So pyrogens are basically bacterial proteins. They are basically lipopolysaccharides, which causes fever and shock if we inject it in our bloodstream. So basically pyrogens are bacterial products. Then what are endotoxins? So endotoxins are toxin materials produced by gram-negative bacteria. So gram-negative bacteria produces endotoxins. So endotoxins and pyrogen should not be present in any bacteria, in any parenteral formulation, as it might cause fever, which is a pyretic, and also it might cause shock. So that's why, what is a technique to get a pyrogen-free parenteral produce? There is a technique called as depyrogenation. And here, according to USP, we have a depyrogenation technique, which is in which we use dry heat at 170 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours. Please remember this temperature and time, because on this simple concept, there were two questions asked consecutive years on depyrogenation. So according to USP, depyrogenation technique involves a dry heat which contains 170 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours. So if our parenteral formulation undergoes at 170 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours, we get a pyrogen-free parenteral product. And for additional information, this depyrogenation technique, which we use by dry heat, it undergoes first order kinetics. So it undergoes first order kinetics. It's an additional information if you want to know. So the most important point in this slide is depyrogenation technique. So according to USP, depyrogenation is carried out by using dry heat at 172 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours. Make a box to this because it's most important point. And so based upon this concept, in GPAT 2020 as well as GPAT 2019, there were one question each. So let's see what question was asked in GPAT 2020. So in GPAT 2020, the question was, pyrogens present in containers can be destroyed by heating the containers at. So the question is little bit twisted. They didn't ask directly mention the depyrogenation temperature. They asked pyrogen present in containers can be destroyed by heating the container at, and the correct answer is 210 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. So this is the correct answer. As we saw, depyrogenation limit is 170 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours. So the correct answer will be 210 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. We get a depyrogenated parenteral container. Similar question was asked in GPAT 2019. Containers may be rendered free from pyrogens by adequate cleaning and by the correct answer is heating at 210 degrees Celsius for 3 to 4 hours. So both in GPAT 2019 as well as in GPAT 2020, the question was on depyrogenation. But they didn't ask directly like what is the depyrogenation temperature and time. But they ask in a practical aspect, in an applied aspect, in which they ask like how the container can be depyrogenated. So like these questions will be asked in GPAT. It will be simple question, but it will be twisted in an applied form. So that's why you have to remember the basic concept. Then it will be very easy to solve these questions. So here we completed the basic concept of depyrogenation and pyrogen-free parenteral product. Now let's move to the next requirement of parenterals, that is free from particles. So we completed sterility, we completed depyrogenation or pyrogen-free parenteral. Now we will see free from particles aspect. So according to USP, there are two methods to determine the particle content in a parenteral product. So first method is by light obstruction, and the second one is microscopic method. So based upon these two techniques, they have given limits how much particles can be present in a parenteral product. and the limits are like, so if we have a small volume injection, which is a SVI, so small volume injection has a volume less than 100 ml or equal to 100 ml. So always remember, any small volume injection will have volume less than or equal to 100 ml. So what are the limits for particles which are allowed to be present in a parenteral formulation? So if particle is equal to or greater than 10 micrometer, then there should be less than 6,000 particles per container. There should be less than 6,000 particles per container if particles are of size 10 micrometer or greater than 10 micrometer. And this limit is for light obstruction technique. So if we use a light obstruction technique to analyze the particle content, particle number in a parenteral product, then these limits are applicable to that method. Then if the particles are greater than or equal to 25 micrometer, then there are 600 per container is the limit. And if we have a large volume injection, which is an LVI, then large volume injection has a volume size greater than 100 ml. So what is the limit for it? So if we observe our parenteral formulation through a light obstruction technique, then the limit is 25 particles per ml. And for particles greater than 25 micrometer, its limit is 3 per ml. So please remember these limits. This might be asked in GPAT examination in 2021 or in further GPAT examination or any other competitive examinations. So according to USP, there are two techniques. First, we saw light obstruction technique. Now let's see microscopic technique. So if we use a microscopic technique to determine the particle content, then the limits are like this. So if we have a parenteral formulation, which is a small volume injection, then the particle size of greater than 10 or equal to 10 micrometer, then the particle should be less than 3000 per container. And for greater than 25 micrometer, it should be 300 per container. For large volume injection, if you observe through microscope, then the limit is 12 per ml. And for greater than 25 micrometer, the limit is 2 per ml. So this is the general limits for free from particle parameter. And each and every product should comply with this particle range. So please take a screenshot of this and please revise it twice or thrice to get it permanent in your mind. There is a simple technique to remember. For microscopy and for light obstruction, the light obstruction limit is twice that of microscopy limit. So as you can see in small volume injection, for microscopy, the limit is 3000 per container. And for light obstruction, it is 6000 per container. Similarly, for particles greater than 25 micrometer, 300 for microscopy, 600 for light obstruction. Similar is observed for large volume as well. 2, 3, 12, 25. So it's a simple technique to remember the limits for particle, free from particles. So then next, these were for the solution. Then we can also administer emulsion through parenteral formulation through IV only and only if the droplet size is less than 3 micrometer. Then only we can administer emulsion through parenteral route to prevent oil embolism. As we saw in previous session, in session 1, we discussed about embolism. If we administer suspension or emulsion having particle size or a globule size greater than 3 micrometer, then it will definitely cause blockage of our capillaries and thus it will cause embolism. And at the end, finished. So this was about emulsion. So based upon this simple concept, in GPAT 2014, there was one question. Globule size of parenteral emulsion should be, and the correct answer is less than 3 micrometer. So your options are 0.1 to 0.25 micrometer, 0.5 to 5 micrometer, 5 to 10 micrometer, and any of the above. So the correct option will be A, which I have highlighted, 0.1 to 0.5 micrometer should be a globule size of any parenteral emulsion. So here we saw sterility, free from pyrogens, and free from particle concept. Now let's move to the last and the most important parameter, which is isotonicity. Any parenteral formulation must be isotonic. That is, it should have same osmotic pressure. So when a parenteral formulation have a same osmotic pressure, that is, it is an isotonic formulation, then only we can administer it through parenteral formulation, and it is safe to administer. So then how we will achieve isotonicity? So there are two most widely used tonicity adjusting agents. First one is 0.9% weight by volume of sodium chloride aqueous solution. This is the most widely used tonicity adjusting agent to get an isotonic parenteral formulation. And as it has osmolarity of 286 millimole per liter, which is in the range of human plasma osmomolality, which is 280 to 295 millimole per kg. Here you can see there are two different concepts which I have mentioned. First one is osmomolarity, and the second one is osmomolality. These are two different concepts, molarity and molality. Molarity is always per liter. So always remember, molarity is always per liter, and molality is always per kg, which we can see here. So the 0.9% weight by volume sodium chloride aqueous solution is isotonic, and it has osmomolarity of 286 millimole, which is equivalent to human plasma osmomolarity, osmotic pressure, which is 280 to 295 millimole per kg. That's why we can use this formulation, agent, which is 0.9% weight by volume sodium chloride, to give an isotonic parenteral formulation. And the second tonicity adjusting agent is 5% dextrose in water. So always remember these two tonicity adjusting agents. First one is aqueous solution of NaCl of strength 0.9% weight by volume, and the second one is 5% dextrose in water. So these two are used to make an isotonic parenteral formulation. Let's revise. Isotonic means same osmotic pressure. So now let's move. Let's see. So right now we saw isotonicity. Now we will see hypotonic and hypertonic solutions, the different concepts of hypotonic and hypertonicity. So as I have mentioned, hypotonic solutions are any solutions which have lower osmotic pressure than our plasma, because here we are comparing with our plasma. So when the solution has a lower osmotic pressure, they are called as hypotonic solution. Then if we administer any hypotonic solution, what it will cause? It will cause swelling and burst or hemolysis of our cells. Because what is osmosis? Osmosis is movement of our solvent through lower concentration to a higher concentration. So if we have a hypotonic solution, the solvent will move from lower osmotic pressure to into our plasma, into our blood cells, and then it will cause swelling and burst and hemolysis. Then what is hypertonic solution? Hypertonic solution is opposite that of hypotonic solution. In hypertonic solution, we have higher osmotic pressure, and there's a movement of solvent from higher osmotic pressure to lower inside our blood cells, and thus it will cause shrinkage and loss of water. So that's why it is not recommended to administer a hypotonic solution or a hypertonic solution, because either it will cause swelling, burst and hemolysis, or it will cause shrinkage of our blood cells. So based upon this simple concept, recently in GPAD 2020, there was question: the crenulation effect on the cell wall is caused by, as you can see here, the crenulation effect on the cell wall is caused by dash solutions, and its effect is, the correct answer is hypotonic and reversible. What is crenulation? Crenulation is none other than shrinkage. Crenulation is another word for shrinkage. So it's a twisted question. They didn't ask directly what hypotonic solution causes, but they asked the crenulation effect on the cell wall is caused by which type of solutions, and this effect is reversible. So any hypertonic or hypotonic solution effect are reversible. If we put that cells in isotonic medium, the effect will be reversed. So the correct answer is hypertonic and reversible. So the crenulation effect on the cell wall is caused by hypertonic solutions, and this effect is reversible. So here we cleared our concept of hypertonic, hypotonic and isotonic solutions. Now let's move to next concept. So by chance, if we have to administer a hypertonic solution, because if our formulation is stable in a hypertonic solution, then how we can administer it? So we have to make it isotonic. So to make an hypertonic solution isotonic, we have to add sodium chloride. We have to add our sodium chloride, dextrose or mannitol, tonicity adjusting agents, to make any hypertonic solution a isotonic parenteral formulation. Now, if we have a hypertonic injection solution, then we have to dilute it to make it isotonic. So if we have a hypertonic isotonic solution, then we have to add tonicity adjusting agents like sodium chloride, dextrose or mannitol to make it isotonic. And if we have a hypertonic injection solutions, we have to dilute it to make it isotonic. So this was the concept of isotonicity. Now, there are various methods to calculate isotonicity. There are five major methods. First one is freezing point depression. Second one is sodium chloride equivalent method. Third one is molecular concentration method. Fourth one is isotonic solution V method. And the fifth one is molecular weight method. For us, from GPAT point of view, and it's easy, and the most important method is freezing point depression method, because previously, each and every year, at least they try to ask one question for pharmaceutical calculation. And isotonicity is their favorite concept or favorite topic on which there will be a question in GPAT. And in that, they always ask freezing point depression method. It's very pretty easy to calculate isotonicity by this method. So based upon this concept, in GPAT 2017, there was one question. Which of the following is a class 1 method used for rendering a solution of a drug isotonic with body fluid? It's a twisted question. They just want to ask which of the following is an isotonicity calculation method. And the correct answer is chiroscopic method, which I have highlighted. Now, they might have asked, they might have given options like freezing point depression, but rather than giving freezing point depression, they mentioned chiroscopic method. None other than chiroscopic method is another word for freezing point. So freezing point depression method is also called as chiroscopic method. So likewise, in GPAT, there will be applied question or there will be twisted question. They won't ask directly what is a freezing point depression method, which is a habit in asking for semester exam. In GPAT, there will be applied question. So likewise, which of the following is a class 1 method used for rendering a solution of a drug isotonic with body fluids? And the correct option is chiroscopic method, none other than freezing point depression method. So now let's see how to calculate. So let's see first principle of freezing point depression method. Because upon this basic concept, there was one question, I think so in GPAT 2020 only, based upon freezing point depression method and its principle. So in freezing point depression method, first of all, let's recollect, this is a concept which we have studied in physical pharmacy in colligative properties. So there are various colligative properties. From that, one is freezing point depression method. So what is it is exactly? So when we add any solute in a water, its osmomolarity will increase and its freezing point will depress. So based upon this basic principle, so if we add any solute, example NaCl, in a water, its freezing point will decrease and its osmomolarity will increase. So based upon this concept, we can calculate the freezing point depression or the amount of tonicity adjusting agent required to make any parenteral formulation isotonic. So if we know the freezing point of any solution or of a blood, so if we know freezing point of a solution or of our blood, then we can calculate the amount of tonicity adjusting agent required to make that parenteral formulation isotonic. So this is the basic concept of freezing point depression method. So let's revise. In freezing point depression method, it's a colligative property in which if we add a solute in a water, its freezing point will depress and its osmomolarity will increase. So to calculate the amount which is required to make an parenteral formulation isotonic, we can use this formula in which if we know the freezing point of a blood or of our formulation, then we can reverse calculate the amount of tonicity adjusting agent. There is a formula which I will show in next slide. Then the next concept is the freezing point of our blood serum or plasma or of tears is same. That is minus 0.52 degree Celsius. Minus 0.52 degree Celsius is a freezing point. Please remember this point. Freezing point of our blood serum or our tears is minus 0.52 degree Celsius. So if we have a solution which have a same freezing point, then that solution is isotonic with our blood serum. That is our aqueous solution of sodium chloride, which freezes at minus 0.5 degree Celsius, is isotonic with our human plasma. And therefore, we use 0.9% weight by volume NaCl aqueous solution as a tonicity adjusting agent because it has same freezing point, same colligative property, and same isotonicity. So this is the basic concept of freezing point depression method. So based upon this simple concept, there was one question in GPAD 2020. So let's read that question. When the concentration of an aqueous sodium chloride solution has the same colligative property. So when the concentration of aqueous sodium chloride solution has the same colligative property as that of the solution in question, the value so obtained is known as isotonic value or isotonicity. Normality, molarity, molality, all are different concepts which we will study when we will study PP. So right now the question is about isotonicity. So when we have a concentrated solution, that is 0.9% weight by volume solution of aqueous NaCl sodium chloride, and it has the same colligative property, that is its freezing point is same, that is minus 0.52 degree Celsius of 0.9% weight by volume NaCl is same as that of freezing point of our blood serum, minus 0.52 degree Celsius. That is, it has same colligative property. And at that time, which value we will obtain? That is isotonicity. So this is the basic concept on which in GPAD 2020 there was question. So if you saw in GPAD 2020-19-17, in recent 5 years, at least there is one question from parenteral formulation, because it's most important in current risk to know the parenteral formulation. There might be less question in oral solids, but from parenteral there will be at least one question. In previous session, in session 1 also, we saw there were question from various parenteral formulations. Now in this session also, we are studying about further aspects of parenteral formulation, along with we studied about microbiology, various sterilization techniques, and pharmaceutical calculations and physical pharmacy through isotonicity calculation. Now let's see what's the formula for calculating freezing point depression method. So as I have mentioned here, there is a formula W is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B. Now here W is none other than percent weight by volume of adjusting substance, that is tonicity adjusting substance, that is NaCl, we can say that we have to calculate how much percent of NaCl or 5% extra solution is going to be required to make a parenteral formulation isotonic. That is W. Then 0.52 is freezing point depression of our human serum or blood. That is 0.52, which we saw in previous slides. Now what is A? So A is the freezing point depression of our parenteral formulation, also called as unadjusted solution or solution in question. That is our parenteral formulation. So its freezing point is none other than A. So here freezing point is always in multiplication with the strength of the formulation. So whenever we have to put the value in A, we have to calculate the freezing point depression of the solution multiplied with its strength, which is asked in our question. We will solve few questions ahead, in that we will get this concept very clear. And what's the B? So B here is the freezing point depression of our water or the adjusting substances. So here the freezing point depression will be mentioned of 0.9% weight by volume of NaCl or 5% dextrose. So always remember, freezing point of 1% weight by volume of sodium chloride is 0.5 minus 0.579. So this data can be given in the question or else they won't give. So you have to remember the freezing point depression of 1% weight by volume solution of sodium chloride, which is minus 0.579. And freezing point depression of blood is 0.52, minus 0.52. But here we don't consider the negative sign as it is a modulus. So the formula is weight is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B. A is none other than freezing point depression of our parenteral formulation, that is unadjusted solution, and B is the freezing point depression of our NaCl or the tonicity adjusting agent. So in GPAD 2018, there was question on the calculation of isotonicity or calculation of percentage of tonicity adjusting agent. And the question was the proportion of NaCl liquid to give 1.5% solution of drug isotonic with blood plasma is. So we have to calculate percentage of NaCl, percentage of tonicity adjusting agent. And they have given the freezing point of 1% solution of drug is minus 0.122 and NaCl is minus 0.576. I have highlighted the correct option, correct answer, which is 0.585%. Now let's see how we arrived at this correct option. So as we saw in previous slide, the formula for calculating any freezing point through freezing point depression method is W is equal to, so formula we have W is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B. So this is the formula. Therefore W will equal to here 0.52 and minus A. So here A is a freezing point depression of unadjusted solution or our parenteral formulation, which will be 0.122 into its strength, what is 1.5%, upon W will be freezing point depression of NaCl, which is 0.576. Please remember, we don't consider the negative sign in calculation of W. We only consider the magnitude or the value. So this will be our calculation. Now what is A? So this is A and this is B. So here A is 0.122 into 1.5%. 0.122 is none other than freezing point depression and 1.5% is its strength. So that multiplication will give us the A value. And B value is freezing point depression of NaCl, that is 0.576. So now let's calculate this. So we know we have to just multiply 0.122 into 1.5 to get our A value. So here it is 0.183. So here the value was 0.183. So the value was 0.183. So 0.52 minus 0.183 upon 0.576. So if we calculate this value, if we minus 0.522 minus 0.183 divided by 0.576, we will get 0.585%. Just for your sake, we will calculate through calculator also. So here we have to minus 0.52 minus 0.183, which we will get 0.337, which we have to divide by 0.576, and we will get our answer, that is 0.585, and the recurring. So the correct answer, correct option is 0.585%. So here the correct answer is second option, that is 0.585%. So likewise, we have to calculate the amount of NaCl or amount of tonicity adjusting agent if the question is like this. So here we used freezing for depression method, and the formula was VW is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B. A is none other than freezing point depression of solution, which is freezing point multiplied by its strength, divided by B, which is a freezing point depression of NaCl, that is 0.576. Just put the numbers in the value and calculate. You will get the correct answer. Then you can revise such various examples from Martin as well as for previous question papers. So this was just a demo. This was just a example for your better understanding. You can solve many other questions through various question papers or various books. So here we studied, here we end this session of second Pharmacopoeia GPAT online session on YouTube. In this session we studied various aspects. Let's revise those aspects. The first aspect was of general requirements for parenteral formulation. There are four basic concepts: sterile, pyrogenic, free from particles, and isotonic. Then the next, various sterilization techniques. Then we also studied depyrogenation technique, which is a dry heat at 170 to 400 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 hours. There were various questions which we solved on this concept. Then we saw the various limits as per USP for free from particles. Then we solved various question, one question which was asked in GPAT about free from particle limit. Then we studied isotonicity and various isotonicity adjusting agents, its importance. Then the concept of hypertonic and hypotonic solutions. Then we studied various formulas, various methods which we can use for isotonicity calculation method. And the most important is freezing point depression method, in which we studied its principle. It has similar, when the solution having similar colligative property, that is similar freezing point, then that solution can be used as a isotonicity modulating agent. And here when we add a solute in a water, its freezing point will decrease, its osmomolarity will increase. Therefore, if we know the freezing point of our unadjusted solution and the freezing point of our blood, then we can calculate the amount of NaCl or a tonicity adjusting agent which we require to make that formulation isotonic. Then we saw one question which was asked in GPAT 20 on the similar lines, and then we saw the formula for calculating the percent NaCl by freezing point depression method, and its formula is W is equal to 0.52 minus A upon B. And we solved one question from GPAT 2018 of calculating isotonicity. So likewise, you should study 2 to 3 concepts together which are correlated. That's it will be very easy to recollect and remember and understand the various concepts and basic concepts, important concepts of pharmacy, and it will be very easy to score in GPAT examination or any other examination. So this is the end of online session second. Stay tuned, subscribe to our channel to get latest update of our GPAT online sessions. Thank you.